can see it now.
So I'll start.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'll take each organ separately, esophagus and stomach. Esophagus, commonly known as the food pipe, starts from after the measured from up from the incisor onwards, supposed to start from the below the larynx and then move on to the GE junction. And this has varied anatomy. It has a rich lymphatic structure, and it is a difficult terrain for radiation oncologists when they are planning their cases. We have previously planned simple 2D RT cases, wherein we have given straight fields. The problem with such straight fields covering the midline, it looks easy on 2D, but if you see the depth, the esophagus curves first straight down, then it curves forward towards the at the level of the manubrium, then near the carina it curves backwards, then goes again in the midline, then finally curves to the side and back before going into the stomach. So with all those curvatures, the varying depth, it is difficult in a 2D RT plan. The fields frequently would cover the interparietal distance from skin to skin. The entire midline of that area would be covered in a field. So this led to complications and therefore limited the dose that could be given. So here, as you can see, the esophagus below in the lower mid area below the carina, you can see it has important structures. The liver has just started, the heart is there, great vessels, the lungs. If you go up also, the lungs are there. Then further up into the neck, the thyroid gland is there, the trachea is there just in front of the esophagus. So there are vital structures all around the target volume. Then as you go down near the stomach, again, you can see a lot of vital structures. The spleen has started. There is the stomach, the liver, the esophagus is bounded posteriorly by the great vessels and the spinal cord, and all around is the lung. So you have to take care of all these structures. Finally, at the GE junction, there is the stomach, the junction, and the esophagus, all three with varying levels of tolerance. Then there is the liver, there is the lung, the posterior, the basal most sleeves of lung all around, and the spinal cord. So basically what it means is treatment of this area is not as simple as you think. This and the fact is that this entire area is richly supplied with blood vessels and lymph nodes, and therefore it is a tough call. So treatment has to take into account the probability of spread or probability of involvement of various nodal stations. So therefore, radiation in esophagus, what should it cover? What should the field cover? Excuse me, to the moderator. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. There's this small pop-up box right in the center of the slide. Could you just move it to the side?
It shows the smaller side.
Okay, leave it then. It just shows the slide in between. Okay, fine. Okay. So what should the field cover? So basically, simulation, imaging, contouring. What should be the simulation protocol? How do we image, contour? What should be the local target volume? What is the regional target volume? These are the questions we ask during planning of radiotherapy. And then finally, plan evaluation, delivery. But that is beyond the scope of this talk, so I'll not go into that portion. So coming to general principles in simulation, presently, it is recommended that CT-based planning be utilized using conformal techniques, and this should be done as a standard of care. The patient should be simulated with their arms above their head to to maximize the number of beams that can be used. If you don't have a 4D CT, then you can estimate the internal motion of the interthoracic organs either by a simple technique is you do the free breathing scan and you do a second set scan on your couch using your CBCT in a slow helical motion, which will capture the entire range of movement of the chest or the breathing, so that you know what is the range of movement of the esophagus during maximal inspiration or expiration. The other technique, but this is a very rough way of doing it. The other technique, if you don't have a 4D CT, is you take the CT images at maximal inspiration, maximal expiration, and a free breathing scan, and then you again check what is the range of movement of the target and the critical structures. So this will give you an idea about what is the margin you need to take. Basically, it gives you the ITD. So also patients with tumors involving the distal esophagus should be kept nil peroral for at least 3 to 4 hours before simulation, and should take measures to limit the bowel gas. So basically, bowel gas will be an impediment to day-to-day reproduction of the target area. And if IMRT is being utilized, even if say 3D CRT, it may not be such an issue, but if IMRT is being utilized, then we use both oral and IV contrast. Oral contrast for the mucosal extent, the IV contrast will help us delineate the nodal fields. The standard GTV to CTV expansions are 3 to 5 centimeter in superior inferior direction. It used to be 5 centimeter in the era of 2D RT. It went down to 3 centimeter when 3D CRT has been used. It was tried to be brought down to 1.5 centimeter with the advent of PET-based planning, but the results are divided. It is still safer to take at least 2 to 3 centimeter margins, superior, inferior, and at least 0.5 to 1 centimeter radial margin. If we are using, now I'll come to the margins. If we are using motion management for simulation, either for simulation and delivery, for both simulation and delivery, or for none. So there are different margins. So as I go on to the CTV and GTV, I will explain the margin. So for involved nodes, the GTV to CTV margin is again 0.5 to 1 centimeter, and the nodal areas should include the periesophageal, the perigastric, the splenic hilum, the left gastric, otohepatis, celiac, and the superior mesenteric artery in addition to the supraclavicular. Now, you would be surprised why you are including nodes such low down into the abdomen, but nearly 30 to 40% of patients with GE junction tumors will have nodes in these regions, and as I have shown in a few case scenarios, we might need to cover these areas. Also, in all esophagus cases, it is better to contour the entire esophagus length and the lung for proper DVH analysis. In upper esophagus, also the brachial plexus and the larynx should be contoured. In lower esophagus, the heart, liver, and kidneys should be delineated. In addition, what I do is, along with the heart, I contour the left ventricle as well as the left anterior descending and the left circumflex artery. The reasoning behind it is that the left ventricle is the place where all the fibers and the pumping action of the heart is going to take place. So I would not like any dose hotspots in that region. It may not be fully possible to completely eliminate a dose in the heart area. So if I use this left ventricle as a more higher constraint area in the heart as a whole, so that the hotspot areas within the or the higher dose regions within the heart are limited to the atria or the great vessel. So basically, I'm pushing the dose to the middle and to the posterior end. The GTV, the CTV, the ITV, and the PTV should be delineated. PECT, PET are used for planning. Endoscopic ultrasound can sometimes classify smaller intrathoracic lymph nodes better than PET or CT. So traditionally, what we have thought, this is a traditional field. So traditionally, what we have thought is GTV will be something small like this. Like this, CTV will then go all around in a regular contour like this, and then you have the PTV. So you could ask me, why do I need an IMRT, or why do I need IGRT? Why do I need motion management? It's so simple, I can do it. But the question is, it is not that simple. The typical radiation fields in the upper esophagus and invert in a Y-shape, goblet-shaped region, in the middle esophagus, straightforward, or in the lower esophagus in the form of a B, are frequently not happening. In the era of PET-based plan, you will frequently come across cases where there are lymph nodes out of the field, and you might have to include those in the field, as well as restrict those to the lung, the heart, as well as other important structures. So it is not regular fields that we frequently get in the esophagus. So what are the margins? As I had said before, the margins depend on what is my simulation or treatment delivery protocol, whether I have taken into account IGRT or motion management. If I have taken one of them into account or none of them into account, firstly, none of them into account, then my margin should be 1 to 1.5 centimeter. If I have taken either of them into account, IGRT or motion management, I just got an annotation request. I didn't understand it. Okay, so... no IGRT or motion management, 1 to 1.5 centimeter. If only one of this is used, then 0.5 to 1 centimeter. And if I'm using IGRT planning simulation, as well as setup and delivery motion management systems, then I can bring down my radial margins to as, or CTV to PTV margins as less as 0.5. And in case, the elective areas in the upper esophagus would be the periesophageal, the supraclavicular, the it can also include the perigastric sometimes. In the lower esophagus, the elective nodal areas would be based on what is the extension of the primary, and you have to include perigastric, splenic, hilar, left gastric, portohepatis, superior mesenteric artery nodal areas. So what are the prescribed doses? Again, there is a range. Upper esophagus means above carina. These can include either the cervical or the upper thoracic esophagus. So the cervical esophagus is typically treated as a lower hypopharyngeal field, and we prescribe doses to the order of 66 to 70 gray in conventional fractions, including the supraclav and going into the towards the manubrium. So it's almost like a mini mantle field, almost like a mini mantle field. So the lower esophagus below the carina is treated as a typical esophagus, from new adjuvant doses of 41.4 gray to even definitive doses of 50.4, and with IMRT now we are getting literature of dose escalations to even up to 60 gray. But a point to be noted in upper esophagus also is that 10 to 20% of your patients will end up getting a stricture, and patients have to be prognosticated. Any dose above 60 gray will carry a 20 to 30% risk of stricture formation, and even in the upper esophagus, and we have to prognosticate and counsel our patients accordingly. Plus, the problem in upper esophagus, especially if there's a cervical extension, is that stenting may not be suitable in this area. So contouring now. First, what to do is contour the larynx as a normal structure. Once the larynx has been contoured, you can the superior border of the supraclavicular lymph node field is you have a sort of a reference marker for the lymph node superior border of your field. So this is at the inferior border of the cricoid cartilage. We contour the bilateral supraclav nodes in electively in the CTV, and the GTV should cover the entire esophagus. So as you can see from these photos, the GTV is the small red, the supraclav nodes are covered in the CTV, and then there is the PTV in light blue. Then as you go down, the periesophageal nodes are included in the CTV. The margin from CTV to PTV, as based on your IGRT protocol as well as motion management protocol. So if you're doing both, then you can come down to a very small CTV to PTV margin. Superior inferior margin still remains 3 centimeter. Radial margin remains 0.5 to 1 centimeter with respect for anatomical boundaries. The lateral boundaries are sometimes larger to account for submucosal spread, whereas boundaries near the bone or facial plane can be restricted to as low as 2 to 3 millimeter. The CTV is shaved off the vasculature and lung parenchyma, so there is no need to just draw full circles around the GTV. You need to shave off the CTV. And as I said, the CTV to PTV margin depends on your imaging protocol and delivery protocol. You also shave off the CTV from the heart. The CTV should extend into the distal esophagus and proximal stomach in case of lower esophageal extension. Posterior extent of esophagus is along the posterior extent is, I'll show in the next slide, is along the vertebral bone. So there will be some parrot beak like projections down the side of the bone. This is to include the periesophageal lymphatics coursing down the vertebral column. So here you continuously cover the PTV down to the PTV down to the celiac axis at the level of T12, and we shave it off the anterior bowel and the pancreas. This coverage should include the periesophageal nodes, the proximal portion of the stomach near the GE junction, and the celiac axis nodes. So these are general rules for esophageal planning, but as I said, esophagus generally does not follow the rules. So what do I do? There are some situations. These are the common situations I have put we frequently face in PET-based planning. So what do I do when we have a locally advanced disease which has not metastasized but gone beyond the conventional portals? We may have situations where a disease is in the middle one-third and nodes are at the GE junction or supraclav, or the disease is in the middle or lower one-third with carinal or supracarinal nodes or celiac axis nodes. So some new new principles have come in esophagus planning. Am I audible? I just saw some pop-ups that the voice is not audible. Is it audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay. So as we know, for locally advanced esophageal cancer, which is not amenable to surgery, definitive chemotherapy is increasingly being accepted as a modality of treatment. The guidelines still limit themselves to a doses of 50.4 gray, but we are getting more and more studies where doses have gone on to even up to 60 gray, and these have shown survival benefits. These are due to use of high precision technology, which can offer less toxicity, and use of motion management to obtain tighter margins. So this is a run up of trials, and as you can see down over here, you have seen, we see some Chinese and Taiwanese studies where they have used IMRT, and with good local control rates, and you can see large number of patients. And as you can see here, they have used doses up to 60 gray. So Chen et al. Has used 66 in 30 fractions. That is almost a dose of near 67, 68 gray. So people have used higher doses now in IMRT, using IMRT, especially SIB-IMRT, where they are giving a higher dose to the GTV and a lower dose to the CTV. So what is the theory behind it? They have broadly now, the Japanese-based studies and the Chinese have broadly divided esophagus into four groups, except the cervical ones, the non-cervical esophagus. It's the upper thoracic, the lower mid-thoracic, the lower esophagus, and the lower most esophagus and G junction. So based on these four types of presentations, you can see what is the lymph nodal involvement. They have included the supraclav and the periesophageal pericarinal nodes. Again, periesophageal pericarinal and peri upper perigastric nodes and the supradiaphragmatic nodes. Then over here, the subcarinal and the periesophageal nodes, and then again down over here. Plus, they have also put a separate field in the C type. They have used a separate field for the celiac axis node. And here, as you go down into the G junction, they have routinely used now the celiac axis. So this is now important in the era of PET-based plan. This is a better reckoner to radiation fields than the old diagrams that I showed at the beginning of the presentation. So esophagus frequently presents now as a multicentric disease, and the signal 8501 trial used extended field radiation right from the crina down to the GE junction. It radiated almost the entire esophagus, and even the latest RTOG 9405, which used 5 centimeter longitudinal margins, could not replicate or give superior improve on the results of this 8501. Now, as I said, as I showed in the trial by Chen and Kim et al., use of SIB-IMRT or volumetric arc therapy using double chemotherapy drugs, it is now possible for extra nodal irradiation, extended nodal irradiation, wherein you are including nodal fields beyond the esophageal area being treated, and you are going to higher doses. This is now possible with the use of modern technology, and this is the Japanese classification for the lymph node in involvement in esophagus. So they have divided into black, gray, white, and solid. So black is the most likely, gray may be the second station, third station is the white, and then the solid are the least likely to. So this depends on your tumor location. Then there is also a concept of IFRT. What they are saying is, do not treat the entire mucosa as a whole, even for extended field. So within the extended field, try and use involved fields. So what we try is within this extended area where the nodal area may be different from the primary tumor, it is better to limit our fields. I'll show you in the case studies. Limit our dose to the primary area or the esophageal mucosa to the area at acute risk of disease involvement and to the basic, the involved nodal stations or to the first echelon nodal station. So based on the area of esophagus, they will be different area. So this is again the benefit of INI, IFRT in esophagus, and these are Chinese studies because again most of esophagus happens either in Iran or in East Asia, and we have got most of our body of literature from that area. So because esophagus will have skip micrometastasis, it is better to use involved field radiations rather than full extended nodal irradiation, full nodal chain irradiation. So these are what I was saying, that you might have a disease lower down in the esophagus with a nodal area around the carina. And in the initial phase of the plan, you might need to include the celiac axis. You might need to include the cardia of the stomach, the esophagus, as well as the supraclav and those particular nodal areas. The boost would be the involved area. So one involved field here, one involved field here. Sorry. So again, the same thing. Your initial field is a large extended nodal and primary irradiation, but your involved field boosts are limited to the PET positive sites only. Similarly, we had another case where the disease was in the middle esophagus and with a small pre-aortic node, and we treated the patient again with a large initial field up to 45 and then a boost, small boost to the involved sites. So using the principles of extended field irradiation for initial followed by a small boost. So the principles, it's nothing new. It's what we have been taught previously. Only thing that the technology is different. So again here, there were two volumes, two skip lesions, middle esophagus, G junction and cardia of stomach. Both of them treated separately with their separate nodal volumes. So again, if you see, this was the initial PTV coverage for 45 gray. And as you can see, the heart is well tolerated. The boost plan also looks good. So we thought that we could put in complement both the plans and still protect those to the heart. But when we added both the plans here, so when we summed up both the plans, this is what happened. The heart was getting a higher dose. So it's not just that you look at one plan, 95% coverage, and you feel happy. You look at the boost and then you feel happy. You have to sum up both the plans, then come down to the tolerable dose, the dose beyond which the heart should not, the dose which is the maximum tolerated dose to the heart, or the OAR which has the least tolerable dose, and then you look at the coverage. In this case, we did not go in for the boost, but we treated with a brachy boost. This is another esophageal case where the lung, as you can see, the lung constraints have been met, the liver constraints, the kidney, all of them have been met. So this is the benefit of modern technology. As you can see, we are able to meet the constraints even in such extended field treatments. So at 15 gray, this is, I was initially showing you 95% coverage. So coming down to even 15 gray, you could probably accuse me that So you are showing 95% coverage, come down to a lower dose, then we'll see. So here, even at 15 ray coverage, you can see that we are able to protect all the organs at risk. So again, in an extended field PTV coverage, seen at 95% prescribed dose, at 42.5 OAR sparing for apex of heart, you can see I am trying to push the high dose areas towards the great vessels and I'm trying to protect the ventricle and the apex of the heart from getting high doses. Again, OAR sparing at 20 gray, this is at 20 gray. Another case, the third case at 20 gray, and you can see I have tried to protect the apex of the heart by contouring this as a separate organ from the heart. I am able to prevent fingers of dose coming into this area. So that's about esophagus. Should I take questions on esophagus now or at the end of the talk?
So we can have it at the end of the talk because we don't have enough questions yet.
Fine, fine. So I'll go on to stomach. Okay. So as per NCCN guidelines, adjuvant, the recommended dose for adjuvant chemoradiation is 45 gray. For definitive chemoradiation, dose is again 45 to 50.4 gray. Though there are studies now which are doing some dose escalation for between 52 to 54 gray. The Quantech says that the tolerance dose to heart, that is 30% of the heart, should not receive dose more than 55 gray. So 55 gray still remains a red line. The stomach. So 30% of the stomach should not receive a dose more than 55 gray. So 55 gray remains a red line. The target volume will include the body of pancreas, the full stomach bed, and all regional nodes. And depending on the part of the stomach involved, the CTV can include the diaphragm, duodenum, or the lower esophagus. So indications for radiation adjuvant treatment after complete resection T2 to T4A or node positive, definitive chemo radiation, palliative. In node positive diseases, new indications are new adjuvant radiation or chemo radiation in heart. So I just saw a pop-up question that what is the extent, what dose is possible in lower esophagus extending to stomach? It is difficult to tell. Where would you put a block line? Esophagus, people have given doses up to 59 gray. Stomach, we still don't go beyond 55.8. So this is the border area. Anyone's guess, I would go with the lower limit. So important points to note. Sorry, I wrote it carina. I think it was a carry on from esophagus. It is cardia, not carina. I apologize. So this is the plethora of organs of risk near the cardia of the stomach. Then coming to the proximal stomach, the proximal body of the stomach. Again, the plethora of, I'm not going to name each. I will run out of my energy and you will run out of patience. So this is what radiation fields entail through the stomach. As you can see, going down, then into the nodal area. There are so many organs at risk. Important point to be noted here is, while the nodal burden in stomach surrounds all these organs, the tolerable dose for liver should be below 20 gray for more than 2/3 of liver, or 25 to 30 gray for less than 1/3 of liver. Mean dose less than 20 gray for the kidney, a Dmax less than 45 gray for 195 cc of small bowel. So we have extremely dose limiting, and of course the spinal cord. So we have dose limiting organs all around the stomach. Add to the fact, and the heart is there sitting on top of the stomach. There is the base of the lungs, and all of these are moving. So near the diaphragm, the superior inferior movement can be 1 to 1.5 centimeter. As we go down, it might be up to 1 centimeter. For gastric cancers, what should the field cover, local and regional? So local extensions can include liver, duodenum, pancreas, colon, omentum, diaphragm. It might include distal esophagus. They can be perineural in patient. Lymph node metastasis is seen in a majority of cases, and the pattern depends on the origin of the primary disease. Two important things again in a stomach radiotherapy planning is the nodes, the stoma, and the remnant stomach. So we have to note the location of these three things: the nodes, the various stoma, and the remnant stomach. So this is a small diagram showing the stomach with the hepatogastric ligament, the gallbladder, the liver around, the greater omentum behind over here, the lesser omentum, and all this area, there will be a rich nodal plexus. Here you can see, so you have groups of nodes, the superior gastric group, the pancreatico-ileal nodes, the inferior gastric subpyloric nodes, and the suprapyloric. So which nodes are to be included in the CTV? In case of G-junction, cardia or proximal one-third stations, 1 to 4, 7, 9 to 13. In the middle one-third, stations 3 to 13. And in the distal one-third, stations 3 to 9 and 11 to 13. So these are standard nodes, nodal areas, which have been recommended in the critics protocol, in textbooks, as well as in the Nancy Lee textbook also for contouring. So you can follow from there. So stomach and regional nodes for RT planning, which are the various stations. So this is the So this is the perigastric node on the lesser curvature and on the greater curvature. Then you have, these are the celiac nodes. These are the common hepatic nodes. Then you have the left gastric nodes. These are important ones. Hepatoduodenal nodes and the splenic nodes. So as I said, the draining lymph nodes are divided into 16 stations, and I told you which ones. So we have all heard of D1, D2 lymphadenectomies. So what do these mean? So a D1 lymph node dissection generally means that only the perigastric lymph nodes are taken out. A D2 is a more extensive, which includes the hepatic, the left gastric, celiac, splenic arteries, nodes along these arteries, as well as the splenic hilum. And the D3 is a super extended, where you go on to within the porta hepatis and the periaortic, right up to near almost L2. So what are the, again, simulation? The same questions we asked in esophagus. Simulation protocol, immobilization, positioning, and image capture. So radiation therapy planning, CT scans, 3 to 5 millimeter thickness. Patient should be in supine position, arms overhead. From the image should be taken from the top of the diaphragm or carina also, right up to the bottom of L4. Patient should be fasting to remove reduce the amount of stomach gas. IV contrast to demonstrate blood vessels. In case we are doing post-op case, then pre-operative scans should be used, and these should be fused with the post-op scans to get an idea about the extent of disease in the stomach as well as the nodal burden. So what are the target volumes? Depends on the gastric bed, remnant or full stomach, anastomosis and lymph nodes. So the GTV would be the gross disease defined by imaging and surgical findings. So either the GTV or the remnant with positive margins. So if there is a stomach remnant, you will put 1.5 centimeter mucosal margin, and after 45 gray we cone down to within 0.5 margin, 0.5 centimeter. So you have a CTV 45 and a PTV 45. Then these are the nodal areas. So So the CTV nodal means it includes the remnant stomach, anastomosis, and the nodal groups. And beyond this, a 1 centimeter margin. This is in case we are not using motion management or we are not taking care what you call breathing movement restriction. So basically, if we are not taking care of IGRT or motion management, then at least a PTV to CTV, CTV to PTV margin of 1 centimeter. It is important to remember that the hepatogastric ligament has to be treated in all cases as it a high area of high risk of recurrence. It is that part of the omentum which runs between the lesser curvature between the stomach and the liver and contains the left and right gastric nodes, which may not be always completely removed. So from the liver, along between the liver and the stomach, this is the hepatogastric ligament. Okay, this is the hepatogastric ligament, and you will have nodes here and along this area. So sometimes we just put a CTV shot over here, that thinking that if I take a bigger CTV, then I might go beyond the anterior abdominal wall. So we frequently can miss out these nodes. So again, then the duodenal stump. It should be covered in patients who have had a partial gastrectomy in distal tumors. But in proximal or stomach or cardiac, stomach cardia patients, we should not include duodenal stump, if especially if they have had a total gastrectomy. Anastomosis are the important ones are the gastrojejunal anastomosis in a partial gastrectomy, esophagojejunal anastomosis in a total gastrectomy. These should be covered as they are frequently seen to be sites of recurrence. Paraaortic nodes should be covered along the entire length of the CTV. Then paraesophageal nodes for you can go nearly 3 to 4 centimeter into the lower esophagus. And in case of superior proximal stomach disease or GE junction tumor. So what did I tell you in the previous is cover the gastrojejunal anastomosis, cover the remnant stomach, and as I said, this is the hepatogastric ligament. So along this area, we should frequently take a sleeve of liver along in our CTV and go down as a put a parrot beak over here so that we can cover the nodal area adequately. Then cover the duodenal stump. If required, cover the splenic hilum and go across the midline and cover the nodal area. Again, covering the esophagojejunal anastomosis. This is again the hepatogastric ligament. This is an important point. And this is the coverage of the celiac artery and extending to along the splenic hilum. So defining the margin for PTV, accounting for respiratory peristaltic motion, bowel movements, and overlap with OARs. These are photos taken separately. So when we have set up a CTV and CTV to PTV, usually it is a 1 centimeter. Yeah, I'll just come. I'm not finished. I'll come to the nodal contouring. I have full photos on the nodal contouring. Please don't worry. I'm getting a lot of pop-up requests on the nodal contouring. I'll just show photos. So because I just wanted to cover the principles first and then I'll show photos on the nodal contouring. So CTV plus 2 PTV margin usually considered to be 1 centimeter unless you have motion management. Also, you take into account the CTV overlap over non-target OARs. So the OARs which are generally not involved. or if there are OARs which are in the area but which you think should lie in the remaining volume at risk and not as specific OARs. So if there is an overlap, the point how to give a prescription is which organ has a lower tolerance. You should decide on which organ has a lower tolerance. If the OAR has a lower tolerance, then that overlap area will have a tolerance matching the OAR, especially if it is a serial OAR. If it is a parallel OAR, then if the PTV coverage is important in that area, then the constraint given to that overlap zone is for the PTV. So frequently what I do in these overlap areas is I create sub PTV volumes where I give a compromised PTV coverage. Finally, taking into account motion management, and it is important to acknowledge organ motion in contouring, planning and dose delivery, as what we have seen that the shifts can be as less as less than half a millimeter, and in some cases it has gone up to as much as 3 to 5 millimeters also. So again, what are the main OARs, anatomical extent and lymph nodal volumes from CT scans. So OARs I have already explained. This is in an intact stomach, what are the lymph nodal volumes. So I'll go phase wise. I think this was what people were asking, so we'll go on this slowly. So first, one second. Yeah, so first we have, this is the left paracardiac. So this is in case of an intact stomach artery planning. So we have the left paracardiac. Then we have the right paracardiac, and this is the area of the hepatogastric ligament. So you have to be careful here. Then we have the greater curvature nodes. So this is the greater curvature nodes. You have the lesser curvature nodes, greater curvature, lesser curvature. Then you have the left gastric nodes. Okay. And infrapyloric and left gastric nodes over here, and the splenic hilum nodes over here. Sorry. So you have the various infrapyloric, and these are the para-aortic nodes. So para-aortic nodes generally are supposed to start from T9-T10 or D9-D10, and the lower para-aortic nodes can go up to even L2-L3. So in an D1 dissection, generally we have dissected out the nodes till the level of the celiac axis, which is around D12, L1 maximum. It is only in the D3 type dissections that we have gone down to L2, L3. So the para-aortic nodes can start at D9, D10. And this is from the article J. White Wo et al. From Practical Radiation Oncology, published in 2013. And they have given a schematic diagram for all. And I'll be showing each of the diagrams in a slightly more enlarged form. So as we go down, so right paracardiac, so the nodal areas are in red and the stomach is in blue. So right paracardiac and the stomach. Then the left paracardiac, as you see here. So right paracardiac will be here and the left paracardiac here. Then along the lesser curvature, you have nodes. So this is the stomach, the lesser curvature, and you have to take the hepatogastric ligament over here. This is important. This is the site of recurrence many times. So again, this is the lesser curvature nodes. Then you have the greater curvature nodes, and these are the pyloric and the suprapyloric nodes. You can see these cuts. Then you have the infrapyloric nodes. So this is the stomach. This is the infrapyloric nodes, and this is again the stomach. And if you see behind over here, along the left gastric artery, these are the left gastric artery nodes, and these are the common hepatic artery nodes. This I have taken from the critics protocol. So the critics paper is freely available. Even the protocol paper is freely available for the contouring and the simulation principle. We are giving extra margin on the left side for the paraaortic nodes in this particular case, because the stomach is lateralized more to the left and the nodal burden is slightly higher. Okay, so generally when you are taking in a different scenario, when you are because I'm just digressing a little off point, I just saw a pop-up question. So if you are planning for the pancreas, your nodal burdens or the nodal contouring would probably equal on both sides. So it just depends on which side is the nodal burden higher. Then again, splenic hilum. So you have the splenic hilar nodes over here and along the splenic artery. You can see, so as you can see, a lot of the nodes are starting along this left portion of this stomach and going into the center portion over here. So the center and the left portion of this the abdominal cavity is the area we are irradiating. Then again, hepatoduodenal, these are the hepatoduodenal nodes over here, and nodes along the posterior aspect pancreatic. So posterior pancreatic core duodenal nodes and nodes along the root of the mesentery. So these could be named as the superior mesenteric artery nodes also, SMA nodes. Then these are also the same along the mesocolon, and finally the paraaortic node. So this in Western literature, frequently we do a PET-based plan and we have a good idea of the nodal chains involved. So in our setup, we can also do a PET-based nodal chain irradiation. After gastrectomy, now you don't have the stomach, or you only the remnant stomach is there. So this purple is the stomach remnant. Okay, so again the color coding is given. This is from that same Wo et al. Paper. You have the paraesophageal node, then you have the periesophageal nodes here. Okay, then you have the pota hepatis and the periesophageal node. These are the nodes along the splenic artery, the paraaortic nodes, these are the celiac nodes, the hepatoduodenal, pancreaticoduodenal nodes. So these are the ones which are important for us. So after a total gastrectomy, again, as I've said before, these are the nodal areas. I have not labeled them because, again, I'm following the same here. So I'm following the same color code from here. So mostly the paraaortic, the nodes along the superior mesenteric artery, the mesocolon, the pancreaticoduodenal nodes, the splenic artery nodes, the celiac axis, the post-pancreatic, the splenic artery again, the splenic hilar nodes, the celiac axis nodes. So these are the nodes we are irradiating after total gastrectomy. Subtotal gastrectomy, again, almost the same nodal bunch. So these are the nodal areas we will take in. And this is these tables. I apologize. It looks a little hazy. I borrowed these tables from the book Nancy Liu et al. For contouring in various organs, various fields. And if you have an esophagogastric junction disease, the remaining stomach should be included. So what should your CTV include? So the tumor bed is T-stage dependent, nodal volume is again N-stage, T3N0 with invasion of cirrhosa, again variable. So I'm not going to read out, as you can see, various situations, T3N0, T4A, T4B, N+, up to T3 and T4A, T4B. So what are the notes you need to take? How much of the remaining stomach or the bed you need to take? Similarly for the middle third and for lower third. Basically, we try to protect 2/3 of one kidney in all cases, and in T3 disease, again, how much of the remnant stomach depends on the surgical finding. The tumor bed, if the entire stomach taken out, then the tumor bed depends on, again, the stage wise and the nodal areas. So again, T4A, N0, T4B, nodal plus T1 to 3 and T4A, T4B. So these are the recommendations according to the book in Nancy Liu. That's all. I would be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, sir. That was a wonderful session. So we have a few questions. Should I start the question, sir?
Yeah.
What is the evidence for elective nodal irradiation in lower esophageal cancer?
See, I have used the evidence from the critics trial that used, they did not do, they have used the involved field, basically notes, depending on what would be the percentage of, probable percentage of nodal irradiation. So, I mean, percentage of nodal involvement. So, the celiac axis nodes, the peri-esophageal and the upper peri-gastric nodes were involved, irradiated in the critics protocol. Now, if you are asking me the question of what is the literature behind using elective extended field nodal irradiation, was that what you wanted to ask?
So the question doesn't specify that.
So because there are two different things. One is elective nodal irradiation in standard field, which we are already doing. We have a body of data. We have from the critics trial their own protocol itself. We have the regional nodes involved, that is the celiac, then the upper perigastric, the periesophageal nodes. So those are the areas, the nodal stations supposedly within the area treated. But if you are telling, if you want to use extended nodal irradiation field, so that is a developing field. As I showed, there were a few studies. One second. I'll just come to that particular slide.
Yes, sir.
Here. So here we have these slides. Basically, they have conventional high dose RT or conventional dose RT, and they have used their fields according to the new Japanese pattern, where this is as per the old standard lymph nodal fields. Now, the concept of extended elective nodal irradiation comes in where you are doing PET-based planning in esophagus, and where you will frequently get a disease, for example, in the middle esophagus or lower esophagus with a node somewhere in the supraclav or near the carina, or you will have a disease in the upper mediastinum and a node in the celiac axis. Okay, so in these cases, it is been proposed that it is better to irradiate the entire periesophageal chain and then include the celiac axis. However, this has also been challenged that such extensive nodal irradiation should not be used. In fact, the first trial using extended nodal irradiation was the RTOG 8501 trial, which started from the base of neck right down to the G junction. The fields were standard. If you read the description of their fields, They were standard 2D fields right from the base of neck to the GE junction. So it's not recent. This literature keeps popping up here and now, and the concept of involved field RT also keeps popping up.
Thank you, sir. Should we include lower cervical group of lymph nodes in addition to the supraclavicular nodes in CA cervical esophagus?
I have done it. I cannot quote you a recommendation, but yes, if you have supra, the teaching is if you have supraclav nodes involved, then it is better to take the next echelon nodes at risk. So the next echelon nodes would not be the level 5, but would be the level 4 nodes. Okay. So you could include them, but as I said, it would mean higher toxicity.
Thank you, sir. So why does the target dose prescription vary based on the location of the tumor within the esophagus for the same histology, and we would expect it to be the same biology?
So far, the history of treatment in esophagus has been such that we have not been able to cross 50 gray because of various toxicities. Okay, so that has been the sort of a red line so far. And now with the success of the CRITICS trial, we are ourselves to between 41.4 to 45 gray as a new adjuvant chemo radiation, and then proceed for surgery. So historically, we have never gone on to a higher dose. Now in cervical esophagus, it has been traditionally thought of as being an extension from a hypopharyngeal, because most of these are squamous cell tumors, and they are thought to be an extension of the cervical, the hypopharyngeal tumors, and therefore they have been given higher radiation doses. But in the literature also, there has been seen that any dose to esophagus above 60 gray will cause significant episodes of this stricture formation. So it would be as high as 25 to 30%. So it's a developing field. Now with the advent of IMRT and the concept of definitive chemoradiation in inoperable esophagus, there are, as I showed, a lot of Chinese and Taiwanese articles, and now some from India as well, who are going ahead with higher doses up to even 60 gray. But so far, no one is trying to cross 60 gray. There was one meta-analysis in 2013, July, reported in the Green Journal. It was a multicentric meta-analysis from Western Europe, where they studied patients who were treated by 3D-CRT. They were given EBRT to a dose of 60 gray, and then they received doses by brachytherapy to an equivalent dose of 72 gray. All these patients were inoperable patients. Okay, and what was seen was that their survival was as good or as bad as conventional patients. None of them had received chemotherapy, but the stricture formation rate was almost 33%. So any dose above 60 gray, definitely you will have high stricture formation.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is, should CTV be shaved off vasculature, or should the abdominal aorta be included in the radial CTV extraction routinely, or should it be cropped?
See, there are books which are saying that you should shave it off. But the question is how much you are going to shave it off. So I would not shave the PTV, but I would shave the CTV, and I would be more satisfied if I am going to use motion management. So if I am not going to use high precision, then there is no point in shaving off. No.
Thank you, sir. So there are a few questions on which lymph node regions are regional according to the site of the tumor. For mid or lower esophagus, supraclavicular lymph node is not considered to be regional and it's not included routinely in CTV delineation. But if we have a lower esophageal tumor with a supraclav lymph node, how do we stage it according to the AJCC?
I'm not going to go stage it. It would be probably either N3 or M1. But we have treated here. So as you can see, the boost over here was in the lower esophagus, and the field has gone. The PET based plan showed supraclav nodes. So we went right up here also. So it has happened, and if you see the lymph nodal patterns of the patterns of spread, the risk of supraclav node occurring in lower, and in fact not even in middle, in lower esophagus could be as high as 19 to 20%. So 1 in 5 patients could have supraclav node.
Yes, sir. So perigastric lymph nodes are non-regional for which part of the esophagus, upper or even the middle esophagus?
I think except lower esophagus, perigastric nodes would be non-regional for both upper and middle esophagus.
Thank you, sir. So when should the trachea be included in the CTV when treating upper esophageal tumors or cervical esophageal tumors?
I would shave off my CTV from as much as the trachea as possible if it is not involved. If it is involved, then I don't know if I will be giving radiotherapy at all. If there is a frank invasion, I may not be giving radiotherapy. If there is an abutment, okay, I would include the posterior half of the trachea, but there is no specific recommendation for it.
Thank you, sir. So how to correlate information about disease extent obtained from endoscopy and correlate it with CT imaging? Any practical tips on how to use the distance from the incisor?
I didn't get your question.
So how to correlate information about disease extent obtained from endoscopy with that of CT imaging? Usually there's some discordance. So how to be correlated?
This question actually has been answered. Endoscopic ultrasound has actually been answered in the CA rectum rather than in esophagus, where they have said that the lymph node staging or risk classification for a rectal tumor should be based on MRI. Endoscopy would help in the mucosal extent delineation. Even in esophagus, rather than the node, it is the mucosal extent delineation that I would be seeing on an ultrasound. Yes, there will be some very small mediastinal or hilar nodes in the middle esophagus, which would be amenable to endoscopic ultrasound technique. Because, see, the endoscope will throw a sleeve of, will light up a sort of along its the sonographic path, it would basically examine a sleeve of tissue, whereas the MRI would examine an entire region of tissue. So you are less likely to miss significant nodal burden in a MRI rather than through the endoscopic ultrasound. Having said that, there would be very small nodes which would be picked up through their altered echo texture by the sonograph rather than by MRI.
Okay, thank you, sir.
So we might have to include both.
Okay, thank you. So should we use lung lymph node IASCL SLC classification for delineating mediastinal nodes while treating esophageal cancers?
Lung lymph node delineation.
Yeah, the classification, the mediastinal nodal classification that's used for lung, can we use that for esophageal cancers?
See, I do not offhand. So those are the 16 lymph nodes in the lung mediastinum, I think they have 18 regions, and for the esophagus, they have identified mediastinum. I mean, the esophagus stomach area, they have identified 16 stations. So yes, if I'm treating the hilum and the mediastinal, I will use the lung lymph node classification to delineate the nodes. And if I'm going lower down into the GE junction and stomach, I would probably use the stomach, the lower GI and the nodal areas. No?
Hey, sir, thank you so much.
But I have never made an effort to remember all the nodal stations.
Hello?
Yes.
So when should elective treatment of supraclavicular lymph nodes be done? There's another question on that. When should supraclavicular nodes be treated electively?
Again, it depends on your... in esophagus, we are now... if I was sitting in the private sector also or in the government sector, I would base, if I have the facility, I would base my treatment decision on a initial PET CT imaging, isn't it? And suppose I don't have, in this rare case where I don't have any nodal FDG pickup, so I would then have to think in terms of elective nodal irradiation. So my elective nodal, I showed you photo. Is the new Japanese, Chinese, they have this classification here. So these are the for the thoracic esophageal carcinoma of the patterns of lymph node metastasis. So if it is in the upper thorax or supracarinal, infracarinal. Supracarinal, infracarinal disease, you include supraclavicular and the periesophageal. Again, just extending to below the carina and at the carina, you include both the supraclav and the periesophageal node. If it has come infracarinal disease into the lower esophagus, you include the periesophageal node as well as the celiac axis nodes. And if it has gone near the GE junction, lower esophagus, you include the periesophageal nodes and the celiac axis, left and right gastric.
Thank you, sir. So there's another question on elective treatment of anterior mediastinal lymph nodes.
I think this is the photo. So again, this basically shows your mediastinal nodes over here, isn't it? And as you can see, as the disease goes down, so even if it is a mid-esophagus disease, there is a high chance of mediastinal nodes or hilar nodes being involved. So you might have to take them. Now, specifically for anterior mediastinal nodes, I still am out on that. I do not recall literature on that.
Thank you, sir. So there's a request to demonstrate delineation of the left gastric lymph nodal region.
Okay. I'll come down. So this is in the intact stomach, okay? And you have first, this is the left pericardiac. Then as you go down, this is the left greater curvature nodes. These are the splenic nodes. This is the right pericardiac nodes, okay? Then this is the lesser curvature nodes here. Fine. And then I'm going down. So this is again an intact stomach. The nodal areas are in red. So these are the right paracardiac nodes. Then these are the left paracardiac nodes. Then again, nodes along the lesser curvature. And as you can see, the left gastric node would be typically, the right gastric nodes would be along this area. The left gastric nodes would be along this area, just anterior to the hepatogastric ligament here. So, and then along the left gastric artery, you have down, as you come down, you have the nodes along the left gastric artery here, coming down here, here. Did I explain the question?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
One more slide I would like to show. Just one second. Here. So again, the right and the left gastric nodes along the gastrohepatic ligament. So these nodes will come down also to and then slope in towards the left gastric artery down. They'll come down like this. So we have to include those areas. So as I come down here, so this area, we have to always remember, it is better to take a sleeve of the liver rather than suffer the risk of a recurrence along this bed.
Thank you, sir. So there's also a request to demonstrate how to create CTV expansion from the GTV in CA esophagus along the length of the esophagus.
I have not put those slides because I thought it would be simple enough. But I'll just do it. I'll just show. One second. So this has been the traditional GTV to CTV. One second. Yeah. So in the upper esophagus, this is from the book from Nancy Liu, above carina, the GTV to CTV margin is 3 to 5 centimeter longitudinally and 1 centimeter axially. From the CTV to PTV, if we are not using any motion management or IGRT technique, then we should take a combined margin of 1 to 1.5 centimeter. If either of the two techniques are being used, then 0.5 to 1 centimeter. And if both the techniques, that is both for simulation, contouring, and during treatment delivery, we are taking care of motion management, then you can hone down to margins as less as 5 millimeter from CTV to PTV. So for the lower esophagus also, the same principles are hold true. And I'll just show the photo. Yeah. So first thing is the larynx has to be contoured. So the larynx has to be contoured. And from that, from the inferior border of the cricoid cartilage, you can start drawing the CTV for the bilateral supraclav node. So the CTV for the supra in for an upper esophageal, this is for a upper esophageal growth. For a middle or lower esophageal growth, it is obvious we draw the GTV, and from the GTV we go up. In if we are now in the present scenario, we are not going 5 centimeter, we go up 3 centimeter is sufficient.
Thank you, sir. So there are a couple of questions on neoadjuvant RT in esophagus. Is there a limit on the length of the esophagus that can be treated in neoadjuvant CTRT in esophagus?
See, the traditional thought has been a length of esophageal involvement more than 8 centimeter long should not be considered for definitive treatment. So if the disease is more than 8 to 9 centimeter long in the primary itself, so if you add 3 plus 3, it's 14, 15 centimeter. So that would be the length of your field for CTV. Add another 1 centimeter for your PTV. So maybe around 18 centimeter. So is your patient going to tolerate? I would doubt it. So presently, I think now we plan for new adjuvant chemo radiation is 3 centimeter diseases, less than 5, better. 5 to 8 also considered.
So is there any difference in the target elective nodal regions when we are doing new adjuvant CTRT in esophagus as compared to definitive RT?
For new adjuvant chemo radiation, there's any difference with respect to targets compared to when we are doing? No, see, now let us take that one case I showed. Middle esophagus with a single preaortic node. Okay. So our plan was we gave 45 gray to standard esophageal field and the celiac axis field. And the surgeon operated, taking into account the nodal area also. So the entire thing was operated. And whether it's for a new adjuvant or for a definitive or palliative, I think that intent first has to be, I think before even simulation, that is the first step in radiotherapy treatment, is deciding the intent of treatment. So once we have decided on the intent of treatment, and if we feel that the field can be encompassed in a single volume, yes, go ahead. But fundamentally, there are, I don't think, any big differences. Yes, beyond 45 gray, the same length, it may not be advisable to treat. So we might cone down to a boost volume beyond 45 to 40, say 50 gray.
Thank you, sir. So there's an add-on question to the question on shaving of the aorta. Should aorta be included if the contact angle with the aorta is more than 90 degrees?
I think my previous answer stands. First, you have to decide on the intent. Is it going to be radical? Is it going to be palliative? So if there is definitive involvement of the wall of the aorta, how much is it going to tolerate? As a great vessel, the aorta would be able to tolerate more than 60 gray pointos. So yes, we could but even then, the per se as a tissue, the aorta is still a tissue barrier. So are you going to, I mean, I have not yet seen a single recommendation telling that include the whole aorta. I would perhaps put in a margin over there, standard margins. If it includes the whole aorta, then okay.
Thank you, sir. Sir, is there any difference in CTV in CA esophagus if new adjuvant chemotherapy has been given for any reason?
That's a tough question for me. So, has there been I think the easiest part would be no appreciable change. So we go ahead always. Hello?
Yes, sir.
So we can go ahead with almost the same plan. Suppose there has been a change, and what am I supposed to do? Is it definitive chemoradiation, or even then, is it operable? So after new adjuvant chemotherapy, is it operable? I think the tumor board, I'll have to take a call on that.
Thank you, sir. So there's a question on FDG PET-CT. Does FDG uptake in PET represent gross disease, or also does it also represent subclinical disease? If it represents both, then in the case of PET fusion, so should GTV, CTV, PTV all be delineated, or only the GTV and a margin of given for PTV?
Could you repeat the question?
So the FDG uptake in PET-CT, does it represent gross disease, or also does it represent subclinical disease? If it represents subclinical disease also, should can we get away by drawing a GTV and then giving a PTV margin, or will we still have to give a CTV margin to the GTV?
See, the FDG in PET, it is actually, it represents the active, tumor cells which are accumulating fluorodeoxyglucose. Okay, so which are the actively basically means that is the actively dividing tissue, or the high oxygen uptake tissue, a high glucose uptake tissue. Basically, that's what it means. So, per se, are you asking me, can it include subclinical disease? I'm at a loss for that. I mean, FDG, we usually use it for GTV, okay? Biological target volume, basically for a biological target volume rather than the GTV. The GTV would be the gross target seen on a CT scan, the anatomical target volume. So FDG is the physiological target volume. So it would be a biological target volume rather than a gross target volume. I would call it the BTV, not the GT.
Thank you so much, sir.
So then you have other FDGs also, no? Which will find out for necrosis and or the hypoxic areas where there is active tumor.